Hello and welcome to episode 6 of the PDPreps podcast. I'm your host, Gus Morris, sports reporter with the Press Democrat. Joined today, as always, by my colleague and co-host, Keenan O'Doherty. Keenan, it is Tuesday, September 27th. We are recapping week 5 of the high school football scene around here in the North Bay. Interesting week. Some local teams didn't fare super well, but a couple very interesting results. So I guess we'll kind of start on that. Look at our rankings for week 5, week 5. Go into our predictions for this week's games, and then wrap up and send everyone on their way. But I guess we'll kind of start off the game of the week last week. We had St. Mary's of Stockton, top 30 team in the state, come to town, play Cardinal Newman in their home opener. First game for the Cardinals in a month. You were there. Keenan, tell us what happened.
Well, let's just say the first quarter and three quarters of the second quarter was an absolute nightmare for Newman. That is probably one of the worst, probably one of the crazier starts I've ever seen. Newman gave up two safeties, both on special teams. They also had a PAT blocked. And I mean, St. Mary's kind of jumped out to an early 9-0 lead. Ended up going into the half. Newman finally scored. Matt Hillman found Zach Kelly, who Zach Kelly had an amazing game. But you know, Newman kind of found some momentum going into the half, and then coming out of that half, they felt like they had renewed energy or something like that, because they came out of the half and really gave it to him so much. Where I think that if those first half mistakes didn't happen, Newman could have won this game. Yeah. But believe it or not, but all credit to St. Mary's. I mean, St. Mary's is top 30 team in the state for a reason. I know they were down one of their quarterbacks, but they still have all that speed and weaponry on the outside. But yeah, I mean, you know, Coach Richard Sanchez said after the game, he can't make excuses, and he's going to put the blame on himself. But ultimately, that nightmarish start kind of doomed them from the beginning. And the fact that Newman was playing mostly with backups too, and to play. Yeah.
And no Santino Acevedo too, which is a big piece.
Correct. To play with mostly backups, give it to a top 30 team in the state, and kind of cut the deficit a little bit from last year. I believe last year they lost by like 20 or something like that. This year they lost by less than that. So, I mean, it definitely was a winnable game for Newman, but yeah, the start doomed him from the get go.
Yeah, it was final was 32-18. I'm sure we'll have that up on the screen here. But for as many miscues as they had, and I was kind of keeping up on, watching this, your tweets, and I think I had the live stream on too. But yeah, I mean, two safeties, and you have a blocked was it a blocked field goal or a blocked extra point? What was it again?
Sorry. Oh no, wait, no. So they missed, so Newman missed a field goal attempt to open the game. Then later on that they had a blocked point after attempt. They also almost had another muffed punt that almost resulted in another safety, but there was a roughing the kicker penalty saved them a little bit. But yeah, as you were saying, lots of miscues, unfortunately.
Yeah, I mean, they'll be working on some special teams this week, but I guess bye this week too for them. So some good time to kind of, figure out what went wrong last week. But yeah, I mean, again, all those things considered, to only lose by two touchdowns. And I think they even had the ball back too, didn't they? I think with like 4 minutes left, and they could have cut it to to a one score game or something.
Yeah, they did. They had opportunities, man. I think the offense definitely settled down in the second half, at the start of the second half, and they were moving the chains. They were effective. Kaze Stevenson, I know he's been back at the Santino, but he's been playing great ball. He had a 60-plus yard scamper that set up a touchdown. Zach Kelly had another great game. Zach Kelly is clearly Matt Hilden's number one target for a reason. He had 7 catches for 143 yards plus a touchdown. Zach Holman had four catches for 34 yards and a touchdown. But I mean, like I was saying about Steverson, 17 carries for 97 yards, rushing, five catches, 30 yards, one touchdown receiving. Hilden was still pretty effective, 22 of 39 for 246 yards and three touchdowns. So it's not like their offense wasn't doing anything. I mean, they were definitely clicking in the second half, but I mean, that's like those miscues in the first half. That was like 10 points they could have gotten back. So that's ultimately what did it, I think.
Well, and then also to put up 18 points against Stockton or St. Mary's, where their previous season high was 20. So again, to put up, you know, 18 points against a really, really stout team like that. Yes, it is a loss, but I think this is very similar to the loss that Windsor had at Escalon a few weeks ago, where, you know, double digits, it doesn't look great on the score, you know, on your schedule at the end of the year, but St. Mary's is legit. I mean, you know, again, they're a top 50, top 30 team in the state. And to kind of hold it close, you know, with them, kind of not even at full strength, I think it's a good sign for Cardinal Newman, you know, moving forward. So, I'm definitely looking, you know, last thing on the Cardinals here, and we'll kind of move on to some other games. But I'm definitely looking at them to, this has kind of been a question of, you know, how good are they going to be this year? I think, you know, they've had some ups and downs for sure in the preseason. Or in non-league season, but going into the bye week at 3-2, not having, you know, having won a couple games, you know, without Santino, they've had some guys step up. I think this Newman team is absolutely going to be in the mix, you know, once we get into league play, like we kind of thought. Definitely some encouraging signs for them going forward.
Yeah, and if you're Santino Acevedo right now, you're in absolute heaven because you get another week to rest. League season is coming up. Obviously, it's a grueling league season. He did suit up this past game, but he didn't touch the field. So obviously, some positive signs on his end. But yeah, another week to rest up for him. Kind of a free week, hopefully we get to see him back on the field come league play.
Absolutely. Yep. The Newman opens NBL Oak play October 7th versus Montgomery. And we'll get into their game too here in a second. But a few other ones before that. Casa Grande, rematch of the game that decided the BVAL title last year. Fell 42-19 to Vintage. Close game of the half, 2013. And then Vintage kind of stepped on him in the third quarter. I believe it went touchdown, takeaway, touchdown for the Crushers, and they kind of just, you know, ran away with it from there. But again, good first half, and then it kind of blew up in the second half. Vintage has their, you know, I mean, their play style just doesn't really feed super well into Casa Grande's play style. I think Casa ran something like almost 100 plays against Montgomery, you know, the week prior, and then I think they might have only managed something like 40 plays this week against, or you know, last week against Vintage. You know, Vintage just holds on to the ball so long, and they just ground and pound, and so it sounded like once they kind of got ahead, that was just kind of their game plan, and it worked out. So tough one for Casa. Drop back to 2-2. I think this definitely puts Vintage back into the driver's seat of the VVAL. That was kind of going to, you know, it seemed like this, you know, that race was kind of once again going to be Casa Vintage. And now it seems like Vintage has kind of established themselves as the clear number one over there in the VVAL. So, Casa back to work this week, hosting Ukiah in a non-league game, and then they go through the rest of the slate. But I mean, their toughest challenge right there was Vintage in league. So I think they'll fare better going forward, but just a tough one to open VVAL play like that.
Yeah, no, I totally agree, and I kind of touch on this in my analysis piece a little bit, but I mean, definitely some early signs for the VVAL this past week. Obviously Casa versus Vintage was really telling. American Canyon had a very convincing win over Sonoma Valley. We knew this was going to be a huge test for Sonoma Valley to see where they were at after starting 3-1. And I guess before we go to Maria Creo, we could go to Petaluma real quick, because that's still in the VVAL. Their defense stepped up incredibly well against Justin Siena, where their offense wasn't firing at all. And Gus, I know you know a little bit more about this game than I do, but definitely some early telltale signs for the VVAL, and it's still as unpredictable as ever. So Petaluma's D stepped up big.
Big time, yeah. Four interceptions for the Trojans. First one was a pick six from Silas Paul-Georges, and then Lucas Vanderlyn also had a couple as well. Dawson Shaw had the fourth. Another game without their starting quarterback, Henry Ellis, Asher, I think it's Asher Levy. I don't know how to pronounce
Levy.
It.
Levy.
Yeah, one of those two. Sorry, Asher, if you're listening to this. But it sounded like he struggled a bit in the first half, but he, you know, kind of composed himself at halftime and, you know, really, you know, played much better, you know, in the second half. And from what I had heard, you know, I talked to, you know, Petaluma head coach, you know, Rick Christ after the game, and, you know, they went into half leading 7-6. Justin Siena is not, we're not quite, you know, I think they came into this one 3-1 coming off of three straight shutout wins. And so it was kind of like a question of, all right, is, you know, where is Justin really going to kind of stack up, you know, in the V
Valley? Like Sonoma Valley a little bit.
A little bit, yeah, because they had lost to St. Helena earlier in the year, like really like 28-0, I want to say. And so it was like, okay, is this a down year for Justin? And then they, you know, rattled off some wins. And then it's like, all right, where are they going to stack up, you know, in the V-Val? And Petaluma was kind of a good test to kind of see where they were. And yeah, 7-6, Petaluma, you know, was leading at halftime. And then second half, Petaluma just kind of same thing as Vintage, just control the ball, control the line. Second half, it was just run. Silas Paul-Georges, 100 yards, 21 carries, touchdown, and he had the pick six. Good game from Chase Miller, 260 yards, 13 carries. And then, yeah, Clay Dennis, too. He didn't have necessarily a ton of, you know, like big, you know, interceptions or fumble recoveries or whatever. But, yeah, Chris, you know, definitely, you know, was like he was kind of our defensive stud tonight, too. So I definitely kind of you know, these last two games for Petaluma, you know, their offense obviously hasn't been clicking as well as it had been, you know, to start. And that's probably, you know, a good chunk of that is because Henry Ellis is not playing. You know, their starting quarterback is dealing with an shoulder injury right now. But to have their defense step up like that, very, very promising sign. That was kind of, you know, I mean, again, you watched the shootout with them and Annalie, and I think, you know, it shows how strong Annalie's offense is. But also it was like maybe Petaluma's defense isn't quite there in the last few games. It's really kind of stepped up and shown, hey, it's they can also, you know, like they can hold their own too, you know, when Petaluma is not scoring as well as they have been in the past too. So, yeah, 4-1 for Petaluma to start. A tough test, I believe. They have Vintage this week, so Vintage is going for the Petaluma sweep.
Well, that's going to be an interesting game just because
it should be. Yeah,
two similar play styles.
Absolutely. So we'll see how that one goes. But anything else in that game, or should we move on to Carrillo finally getting in the win column?
No. Is Carrillo the best 1-3 team around, Gus?
I would say they are. man, after, I mean, literally coming off of.
They got one on the board.
They got one on the board. 32-12 over Santa Rosa. Kind of more of the same stuff from them. A couple of huge games from their running back, Sam Mortimer and Gio Lucchesi. Okay, I think that's how you pronounce it. Apologies if I'm not pronouncing that right. Yeah, I mean, 186 on 11 carries for Mortimer, touchdown, and then Lucchesi had 183 on 5 carries, which is just freaking insane. You know, some more huge runs, huge plays. That's kind of been the Carrillo's MO this year too. Is, you know, they've, you know, their offense has just been, you know, rolling on the ground, and they just get these massive scoring plays. So on in the win column for the Pumas. You know, again, coming off of those heartbreaking losses from Casa and Petaluma, kind of last minute, last second scores, you know, led to defeats there. You know, again, a few balls break their way, and they're a 3-1 team easily this year. So, Carrillo is definitely, I think, you know, going forward, they have a really good one this week against Annalie, which it's not our game of the week this week, but it was definitely up there in the conversation. That'll be a really good one, a non-league game for them. And then I think the schedule gets a little easier going forward until that St. Vincent game to end the season in early November. But yeah, Carrillo showing some signs here that they're, you know, I mean, again, it's really tough to kind of bounce back from an 0-3 start like that with some heartbreaking losses. And, sure. You know, they did in a good way last week. So good dub for Carrillo.
No doubt. And I think I was kind of looking at this a preseason as well, because they how their running back, like little running back carousel was gonna fare. And you know, once Jay Higgins, once he gets that wing T offense going, it is pretty hard to stop. So you know, I think their so far their story hasn't been that they haven't been competitive. They just haven't been able to close out games. So it's good to see him finally close out one in a pretty convincing fashion. So hopefully this this gives them a good wave of momentum and keeps them competitive in the Redwood. But yeah. Gus, man, let me tell you. So you probably went to maybe one of the best games in a while on Saturday. You were in your stomping grounds, Petaluma, St. Vincent, Montgomery. St. Vincent with a statement of a win. Just talk to me, man. What happened?
This was, this is the second time this year I picked against St. Vincent, and they made me look just absolutely foolish again. I've learned my lesson, Trent and co over there. 49-28 win, St. Vincent over Montgomery. The final score makes it look closer than it was. St. Vincent had, or Montgomery had, I believe, three scores in the second half on some big plays. But, I mean, fourth quarter was running clock. St. Vincent led 42-7, at halftime. First half was kind of the story of the game. You could not have asked for a better first half from St. Vincent. Even head coach Trent Herzog was saying, he's like, I think that's the best half we've ever played. Kyle Hall, their star running back, who had, 252. I had him down for 256. St. Vincent's staff had him down for 272. Either way, monster game for him. He had, he even said too after the game, he's like, I think this is the best game that we've ever played since I've been here. And he's a 4-year senior, or 4-year varsity starter for them. So, in all regards, that first half was incredible. First two plays of the game, Jarrett Bassage finds Jack Davis for, I believe it was a 73-yard touchdown, for a pass just over the top, beats his defender on the outside, boom, he's gone. Montgomery comes right back. First play of the game, Lucas Foy to Joey Bowser, 69-yard touchdown. And I'm like, oh boy, here we go. We got a shootout coming. This is going to be exciting. And then from then on, it was just all St. Vincent. They had Jarrett Bassage had a scoring run of, I think, 75 yards on their next, next possession. Kai Hall got loose for a big one. Montgomery also turned the ball over three times in the first half. I believe it was three times in the first half. They had two fumbles, I want to say, and then Jarrett Bassage also had a pick. Huge game from Jarrett Bassage too. He had that interception. He also had a fumble recovery. Passed for 90 something yards with a touchdown, and then 100 plus yards on the ground, I believe also with a score. So huge game for him. Kai Hall again, 26, 25 carries, four touchdowns on the ground. I think his second best rushing output game ever in his career. And this is a guy who's probably going to go down as one of the best ever, running backs in, history around here. So like you said, in all regards, this was a statement win. And just some context too. I mean, St. Vincent, this is a school with less than 200 kids. I mean, this is a school that's Division VII. They're the reigning, NCS Division VII champs. They went to a state playoff game last year. Montgomery has something 1,600, 1,700 kids. This is a school that's 10 times as big, as St. Vincent, and St. Vincent just kind of handed it to him. A few things too on Montgomery. They really did just kind of come out flat. It was, I'm not making any excuses here. I'm not taking anything away from St. Vincent. It was a hot day. St. Vincent is used to playing on Saturdays, under the sun, in the heat. Montgomery, not so much. Not an excuse. They just, kind of came out flat, weren't really tackling super well. I was over on their sideline for the first half. Guys were winded. Guys were asking for breaks. So whatever that may be, again, huge credit to St. Vincent too for kind of smelling blood in the water and just kind of taking it to him right off the bat too. So, and then a bit more context too. I mean, if you're familiar, with the football scene around here, St. Vincent and Montgomery were both in the NBL Redwood last year. They shared the the league title with Santa Rosa in a three-way tie. And in the head-to-head matchup, Montgomery beat them 30-21, and it was pretty close until I believe there was a late score from Montgomery, and that's what kind of sealed it. So, on paper, you're looking at these two schools of Montgomery, huge school, tons of athletes, one of their biggest, biggest teams they've had in years, one of their most talented teams they've had in years. And then St. Vincent, you know, the same kind of thing, you know, their program is absolutely, you know, like going in the right direction. You know, where does St. Vincent kind of stack up in the hierarchy of all the football, you know, teams we have around here? You know, it's, you know, it, I think our top three is pretty clear with Rancho, Newman and Windsor. And then, you know, that fourth spot, even for our preseason ranking, we weren't quite sure what to do with it. I think we had Montgomery or Casa there, I want to say.
Awesome.
Casa there to open the season. And then Montgomery even jumped up there at 1.2. But now it's, I think at this point it's become abundantly clear that St. Vincent is absolutely in that upper echelon, regardless of size. I don't know if they're in our, if they're in the top three, you know, I don't know if they're going to, you know, unseat Rancho, Newman or Windsor, but I do think that they've clearly established themselves as, regardless of size, they're one of the best teams in this area, at least for the season. So, yeah, I don't know what else I could say about this game, but it was I was pretty stunned. And I got to say, a lot of other, you know, I know there were some other coaching staffs were in there, too. And it was kind of one of these things of like, holy cow, what's happening right now? But St. Vincent, they saw the, you know, they saw the, a lot of it, too, is they wanted to earn some respect. And they I'd say they did that, and they did that and then some this week. So huge, huge win for them.
Yeah, well, kind of what a way to bounce back after last year's loss. But you know, my X factor. I'm glad my X factor showed out in Jared Passarge. We were wondering how well he was going to play, especially against that run defense. We knew Kai Hall was going to do well, but you know, he was pretty efficient, it sounds like. So, good job for Jarrett. But like you said, and I guess we can transition into the rankings here. You know, St. Vincent has made their case so much stronger about being in that top three. We're still not sure if they're going to get in that top three just as of yet, but we have Rancho, Cardinal, Newman, and Windsor, our top three in this week's rankings, stay put. St. Vincent as well stays put. Number five was a little tricky just because so many teams were off. You know, so we kind of went around the area to see what teams could have a case for top five. But Gus, I'll let you explain our rationale for our fifth spot.
Yeah, so Annley, well, they were also, yeah, like you said, Rancho, Windsor, and Annley all were off last week. But we're moving Annley up to our fifth spot. I believe, who did they knock out? I'm trying to remember. I think they knocked out Casa.
Maybe they stayed there. No, they didn't.
Who did we have last week?
Who did we have last week?
We should know this, but this is, yeah. Anyway, this is
because we had St. Vincent at four, Casa at five.
Casa at five. All right. So Antley's bumping Casa out this week. Yes, Antley was off, but I believe it was between them and Petaluma for our fifth spot. Petaluma, you know, won this week, you know, moved to 4-1. And yes, Antley was off, but kind of when you look at their season so far, Antley does have a head-to-head win over Petaluma. And like, while it was a loss against San Marin, the fact that Annley has played San Marin, that's the best team on either of Annley or Petaluma's schedules so far this year. And yes, while it was a loss, it was a close loss, and they probably could have won that game. So I think for now, Annley moves up to five. And then, yeah, we have Petaluma, Monte Casa, and Maria Carrillo currently on the bubble. So I know we've talked about St. Vincent quite a bit, but I do think it does bear a little more litigating here, you know, in our rankings. You know, I know Cal Preps has them over Newman, over Windsor, over Annley. You know, CalPreps computer rankings has them as the number two kind of, you know, or number three, I want to say, team in all the North Bay, you know, like, you know, including MCAL, VVAL, MBL, all those things. So I don't necessarily agree with that. And before St. Vincent people come at me, you know, with pitchforks, I just also want to take a look at CalPreps kind of strength of schedule as well. You know, if we are going to go off of CalPreps rankings, St. Vincent currently has a negative 14.3 strength of schedule. And then both Newman and Windsor are in the pluses in that regard. So again, if we're going to go off of CalPreps rankings, I just say look at strength of schedule as a reason why we're having, you know, St. Vincent kind of below those other three teams. But I will say it's an absolute shame that we're not going to see St. Vincent playing one of these top three teams this year, because in years past, I think it probably would have been a very one-sided game. I don't know if that's the case anymore. I don't necessarily know if St. Vincent could beat any of those teams, but it sucks that we're not going to be able to find out this year, because I think this is the best St. Vincent team that, you know, I've ever seen, that I think they've ever had in at least the last few decades. And I think that they can absolutely punch above their weight class, like we saw this week. Mm-hmm. So I would love to see a St. Vincent Newman or a St. Vincent Windsor or St. Vincent, you know, St. Vincent Rancho game, just to kind of see where exactly, you know, they stack up. But for a small school, what they've done in the last few years, you know, with Trent Herzog, you know, at the helm, kind of building that program, it's beyond impressive to kind of go from a team that was playing in the NCL1, playing as a freelance team, to now, again, we're talking about them in the conversation of being a top four team in the entire county. So that rise is incredible. I just think that the three teams we have ahead of them are just in a higher echelon than they are. So again, it's no disrespect to St. Vincent. I know that they'll probably take it a little bit like that, but
they're coming after you. They're not coming.
They're
after
coming
me.
After me. They're coming after me. But I think what they've done is incredible. I just don't know if they're up there with the big dogs that we have right now, you know, in the county. So that's my two cents.
Yeah, no, I totally agree with you, man. And like you said, this is the year to do it, to see St. Vincent play one of those teams, just because it would be super entertaining. I mean, if you put St. Vincent versus Newman, Santino versus Kai Hall, that would be a running back matchup for the ages. You know what I'm saying?
It would be pretty incredible this year. And I don't know what the outcome would be. You know, I think in years past, it was a pretty clear cut win for one of those bigger schools, but this year, I don't know. I mean, again, we saw how they handled Montgomery, and maybe it wasn't Montgomery's best day, but they still came out and punched him in the mouth and never looked back. So I also, you know, again, for all this being said, I don't think it's a stretch to say now that St. Vincent is maybe, if not one of the best, not one of, but maybe the best small school in the Bay Area as far as football goes. I don't know, you know, D5, D6, D7, you know, whatever distinction you want to put for that. Yep. I don't think it's a stretch to say that they are up there as one of the best small school teams in the Bay Area. So I'm very, again, I think with this win, I got a text or two from some people being like, wow, St. Vincent is going to win a state championship this year, like based off of that game last week alone. And I don't think I think that's a pretty safe bet too. Again, I don't want to look too far ahead of myself either, but I think I don't know if anyone in Division 7 is going to challenge them in the NCS. I think they're pretty set for another state playoff game. And then the real big question here is, are they going to get bumped up now to a division? Because that does happen for the CIF state playoffs. Is that, yep. You know, I think last year they played, I don't remember exactly what division, but I think they might have got bumped up one, maybe not. But shoot, I mean, with the way they're playing this year, who knows? I think that they might, there's a chance that, you know, that they might get bumped up into a higher division for state playoffs. But again, long way to go. So we'll see. But they have a huge game coming up a couple weeks against St. Bernard's, coming back down to Petaluma. They have a bunch of guys eligible now who they didn't have for that first game. So that should be a great one. And then, coming down the stretch too, they have Maria Carrillo, who's looking like they're, you know, who's going to be, they're probably their biggest competitor in the NBL Redwood to close out the season early there in November. So a couple more good ones coming up for St. Vincent, but coming off this win, I don't see anyone else challenging them as far as local teams around here. So until Korea, maybe. So.
Nope. I totally agree with you. Totally agree with you there. St. Vincent is on the upswing for sure. Let's head to our game of the week real quick. We're heading to the NCL1. Gus, you will be at this game. Cloverdale is riding a wave of momentum right now. They are going to host league powerhouse Willits. And Gus, this might be a crucial game to decide league standings when it's all said and done.
Yeah, so we're doing some small school action this week for a game of the week. I don't think it's been a while since I think we've covered Cloverdale, maybe a couple of years, honestly. But Cloverdale, new head coach Taylor Galloway, the nephew of former longtime St. Vincent head coach Gary Galloway. They're 3-1 this year, coming off of three straight wins. They just beat Fort Bragg last week 40-0 to open NCL1 play. And they're hosting Willits, who is all of a sudden looking like the favorite over there, the NCL1. They beat St. Helena, you know, the defending NCL1 champ, I think by two touchdowns last week. So huge kind of you know, huge game. For these two programs, it seems like Cloverdale Willets are probably going to be in that upper echelon of teams over there in the NCL1. In this game, you know, like Taylor Galloway was, you know, told me over the weekend, he's like, you know, this game probably could, you know, decide the NCL1 title this year. I think Clear Lake's also up there. I guess they're pretty good this year too. And again, Cloverdale still has to beat St. Helena as well, but kind of a very early league test for these two teams. And yeah, we'll be checking it out. Doing a 100-yard walk on Tuesday. I know we're still working on some equipment things to get through, so hopefully I don't jinx this again, since my one inverted with Montgomery didn't also work out because of technical issues. But and then yes, Friday night we'll have some coverage of that one. And it should be a good one. Again, been a while since we've covered Cloverdale. I know that they have some new football facilities, new field, I believe. So yeah, I'm excited to kind of get out there and see what Cloverdale football is all about this year.
Should be a good one. It'll be exciting to go back up there. All right, so let's get into our predictions a little bit before we round things out. So our records last week, Gus, you were at 8-2. I was at 7-3. So I'm, you know, doing a little better, getting the hang of things a little bit more. Gus, overall, you are 44-20. I am 37-27. And let's start these predictions with our, with the game of the week we just talked about. We're splitting this one. Gus, you're going with Willets, and I am going with Cloverdale. Anything else you want to add to that?
I do want to see what Cloverdale is all about. But from what I've seen so far in the last few weeks, at least from the results from Willets, it's looking like they're kind of a juggernaut this year over there in the NCL1. So, and also too, you know, I'm going to give some Cloverdale, you know, some motivational material, you know, right here. So, I guess that's where
you are the motivational king, apparently.
It is. I've heard from some coaches where they, you know, I picked against them and they're like, yeah, we put that one up on the bulletin board. So, Cloverdale, you're welcome. I'm picking against you guys this week. So, well, it's
all right. I got the Eagles. I'm going Cloverdale. Sonoma Valley at Justin Siena, kind of two teams who we didn't really know how they really stacked up last week. They both lost in their VVAL openers. So fitting enough, they play each other this week. We're both going with Justin Siena. Gus, what do you got to say about the Braves?
Yeah, this is, I honestly think this will be a close one. I kind of think this might be a pick 'em. I think this will be a really good indication of kind of where Sonoma Valley and Justin Siena honestly stack up, in the VVAL. Justin Siena, like, neither team has played an extraordinarily tough schedule so far, but knowing Sonoma Valley, I think might be more talented, but I think Justin Siena as a team, you know, maybe a little older. Sonoma Valley super young. And again, it looks like Justin's defense has been pretty solid the last couple of weeks. And then, you know, Sonoma Valley too. It's like, how do you bounce back from, you know, losing by 50 to American Canyon? So, I think this one will be close, but it's also on the road at Justin. So, I'm going to go Justin Siena on this one.
Yep. From one Petaluma school to the other, Vintage is playing the Trojans this week. They are heading to Petaluma, two very similar play styles as we kind of touched on before. We're splitting this one again, keeping things interesting. Gus, you're going with the Crushers after what they did in the second half against Casa last week. However, I do think that Petaluma could put up more resistance, especially on the ground. I'm just going to go on a whim. I'm going Petaluma. Hopefully Rick, Chris, and Co., that offense can play a little bit better than they did last week, start a little bit better, but it's meant to be seen whether or not Henry Ellis will play. But you know what? Why not Petaluma? So I'm going Petaluma, but guess you're going with the Crushers.
Yeah, picking the upset there, Keaton. I like it. I think, again, from what we saw last week, Vintage is kind of the clear-cut favorite. Petaluma, with or without Henry Ellis, I think that Vintage's defense is just freaking solid. I mean, again, to kind of hold Casa to just 19 points says a lot about what they can do. So I think it's going to be hard for Petaluma to score. And Vintage, too, they have like 60 kids, you know, usually on their team. So they're just crazy, crazy deep. So Yeah, I think it might be close for a half, but I think Vintage is the better team in this one.
All right, Maria Creot, Annalie coming off a bye. They should be refreshed, reduced, all that fun stuff to throw that high-powered offense at Maria Creot. For me, I just think that that air raid attack that Annalie has is just going to be too much for Creo's defense. And Annalie, I just think it's the better team in this one. What do you say?
Yeah, this will be a fascinating one. I think this one could also be a bit of a pick 'em. This could also be a good rust versus rest kind of situation here, where again Annalie's been off. Sometimes teams come off a bye. It's kind of hard to focus up. When you don't have a game and it kind of throws you off your rhythm or your routine or whatever. Not that these guys haven't played off a bye before, but Creo again. They just got their first win of the season. They're hungry. Like you said, I think this will be Annalie's high powered offense is going to be really hard to stop. That being said, too, I also think that Creo's running game, from what I've seen from, I think, the one game that I watched against them, the San Marin game, and then, you watch them in the Petaluma game. Running backs kind of have their way with them a little bit. So I think that could be a huge thing as well. I don't think this will be a one-sided score at all. I think this will be close, but I think in the end, Antley's firepower is too much.
Yeah. Next game on the docket, we got Healdsburg versus Irvington. Healdsburg's not having the greatest luck this season, Gus. I'm sorry about your Greyhounds. But we both don't think that it's going to change this week against Irvington, especially after that last week's loss against Kennedy.
Yeah, it was. I was actually working from home here in Healdsburg last week, and I headed out to the game just before halftime, just to kind of check in on my Greyhounds, see how they were doing. I think it was 22-0 at that point. They lost 44-8 to Kennedy, who again is undefeated, but smaller school, not a great result. But I was there just before halftime. And I'm like, hey, they might get a stop here. Get a touchdown, open second half, things could look good. And then they give up a Hail Mary touchdown pass to a wide open guy in the end zone. I'm like, okay. So Healdsburg, again, I love you, but 0-5 to start the year. I hope it gets better this week, but Irvington's coming in 3-1, almost beat Napa to open the season. And then coming off three straight wins. So Irvington in this one.
Yeah, Irvington almost beat Napa away too. That's pretty impressive. All right, Ukiah at Casa Grande, obviously another team coming off a bye in Ukiah. Casa Grande is going to be pretty upset after their loss at Vintage, where they kept it close for a half, then kind of let the brakes off, let the floodgates open a little bit, but. Casa's got to take their anger out on somebody, and I think Ukiah is going to be the poor victim. I just think Casa's too much.
Yep, I'm with you on that one. Who knows? I think this one could also be maybe a little closer than it might seem on paper, but yeah, I think same thing. I think Casa is just the better team this year, so Casa in this one.
Yeah. All right. Rancho at Pleasant Valley. Rancho's had a week to kind of sulk in their loss against Van, and they're out to get right back on track, and I don't think there's anyone really better than Pleasant Valley if you're a Rancho Cotati fan.
This is a long road trip for Pleasant Valley this week, or for Rancho this week, Pleasant Valley all the way out in Chico. Last year, they handled them pretty well when they came to Runner Park. We'll see how that differs this week going on the road. But, Rancho, from what we've seen, these first, four games of the season for them, barely losing by one to Vanden and then pretty much hosing everyone else. Rancho is legit this year. And I don't, Pleasant Valley is definitely, a powerhouse over there in the San Joaquin section and, smaller. Are the San Joaquin actually now? No, I'm thinking about that. Northern section, excuse me. Again, they're one of the best teams in the Northern section. But again, Rancho is one of the best teams in the North Coast section. So, from what we've seen so far, I think Rancho has what it takes to go far this year. So, yeah, Rancho in this one. I think they'll probably win by a few touchdowns. And then they're coming back home and opening league play a week after, I want to say. Pull the schedule up.
I believe so.
Yeah, home against Annalee next week, and that should be an awesome kind of shootout game. So, I think Rancho heads into that one 4-1.
All right, Windsor making the long trip down south to Skyline. Obviously, they bounce back in the bounce back before their bye week, and we figure that their momentum doesn't stop here. We're both going Windsor. I think just Windsor's the better team.
Yep, same here. It's 1-2 Skyline. Not really any results crazy impressive. I think this is going to be a good tune-up game for Windsor heading into league play. I don't think this will be much of a challenge for Windsor, if I'm being honest. Good tune-up game for them. Good get-right game, and then back to work next week with league play.
Yep. All right, Saturday, October 1st, Saturday game. John Sweat at Rosen University Prep. Rosen's at home this week. We are taking the home dogs in this one. That's a 12 p.m. start. Gus, what do you got to say about Rosen?
Yeah, tough loss for them last week against Tamales. I think we had both picked Rosen Prep to win that one. Tamales was also winless going into that one. Thought maybe REP would have a chance. Did not, unfortunately, but... another good chance for a win this week. John Sweat was the only team that they beat last year. I don't know a ton about Sweat this year, but I believe they're also still looking for their first wins of the year this year. So one of these games that I think that is very winnable. Yep, 0-3 for John Sweat. So another very winnable game, I think, for REP. And I think if at home this time, I think they're going to get one this time. So win column for Rosen this week.
Yep, no doubt. So again, a little bit of a shallow slate this week. Obviously, we got some byes. St. Vincent, Montgomery, and Cardinal Newman all have bye weeks before starting league play next week. So a little bit shallow slate, kind of like last week, but we still could have some interesting games on the slate this week, no doubt. Quick programming programming note on my end. I will not be at a game this week, kind of like what Gus did last week. I will be on the ones and twos, managing social media, producing some stuff online. So, Gus, you will be at Cloverdale. We will also have a roundup of some of the action Friday night as well. So no game coverage for me, but make sure you follow Gus for the Cloverdale action. Also, follow at our Twitter account at PDPreps. My Twitter's at KODority22. Gus's is at JustGusPD. And you can catch all recap analysis, all that fun stuff, pressdemocrat.com/sports/PDPreps. Gus, anything else for the good of the order?
No, I guess one thing coming up. We'll probably record our next podcast. What day is today? The 27th. Where the hell are we? I'm in August there. One thing too, I guess, for next week. So October, I believe it was October 7th, is going to be the that North Coast section meeting about the All Empire or the Redwood Empire football realignment. It looks as though this is going to be moving forward and will be taking effect in 2024. It just now is a matter of what do these leagues look like? And then other details along the way of league champions, automatic qualifiers, is there going to be movement up and down between these four different leagues? If you're not, familiar with this topic yet, go look on PD, on pressdemocrat.com/sports/PDPreps. I've written about it a few times. And there will be, it seems like, a final vote on this by the 27 schools in the conference happening next week. I believe it's the 7th is the meeting. So I think after that happens, I'd like to have maybe a guest or two on and kind of talk about what that means and what that looks like kind of going forward. It could be a pretty substantial shakeup here for football in the North Bay. So. Something to watch out for coming up. We'll have some coverage of that, when it happens. And then also too, Ken and I have been starting to get into a little more of non-football coverage. So, we had some cross country stuff last week. We're going to have some more volleyball coverage probably coming this week. So, things are kind of kicking into high gear. We're going to have you cover as much as we can with how much is going on and kind of staff we got. So, stay tuned for all that stuff coming up and more.
Yep, no doubt. And Gus, just to reiterate for people who haven't heard about the realignment thing, that's just for football only, correct?
Just for football only. Yeah, good point there. Yeah, so this is just so you know, all of your NBL Oak and NBL Redwood teams will still be the same going forward for everything other than football. But yeah, no, I've heard that there might be some discussions about maybe making, you know, branching this out into doing a larger scale kind of realignment as far as you know, other sports go. But I think football is kind of the whole trial run here. They're going to see how it works out for this next alignment schedule from 2024 to 2028. This is not taking effect next year. It's taking effect the year after that. So 2024 season is when it will be taking effect, unless something crazy changes or happens. But
sure.
Yeah, I think that this is kind of a test run for doing this for other sports. And yeah, it'll be fascinating to see.
Nope, no doubt. Well, that's it for us on this episode of the PD Preps podcast. We appreciate you all for listening and or watching, and we appreciate your support as well. We've been hearing some good things. We've been somewhat a little bit of like celebrities, I guess, being noticed at games because of the podcast. I think that's pretty funny. But anyways, we appreciate your support. We appreciate you guys for listening/watching, and we will see you next time on the next episode.